We've all seen animal tracks in the snow, often made by an animal that's long since gone. Did you ever wonder how those tracks were formed? What was the gait pattern that the animal used to create the series of footprints that you're seeing? This is a series of videotapes done in slow motion, so you can analyze the animal track that's formed against the gait that's used to give you more of a clue as to how to interpret animal tracks when you see them in the wild. Especially with wild animals, it often takes years of experience to learn the correlation between the trail that is left behind and the gait that was used to create that track. Even if you see the track as it's made, it happens so fast that it's hard to see what is happening. Okay, I'm going to show you a simple first example here. And what I'm going to have my dog do is I'm going to have her walk through a puddle of water, and then we're going to walk together on this concrete path. And you're going to see how the footfalls land on each other. And the most important point I want to get across here is that the footprints of the rear feet end up being pretty much exactly superimposed on the footfalls of the front feet. So when you see a path of an animal walking in the snow, what you're really looking at is you're looking at two footfalls, not just one. Okay, here's a little different kind of a footprint. This is an animal walking, and you can tell by the blown out snow that the animal was walking from here along this path here. You can get a bit of an approximation as to the animal's size by measuring the distance from one footprint to the next, in this case 16 inches. And you take that number and you double it, and that's roughly the distance from the hips to the shoulders, a rough approximation as to the animal's size. In a walking animal, there are clear advantages to superimposing the rear paw strikes onto the front paw prints. It means that in deep snow, only the front feet need to put in the extra effort needed to break trail. Even when not breaking trail, the mind is freed to consciously plan footfalls for only the front feet, so that short-term attention is available for other tasks. Those advantages are not so useful in a sprinting animal. In that case, speed and acceleration are more important than the energy conservation effects of superimposed footfalls. The advantage of bounding paw placement is greater than the disadvantage of separate footfalls. Okay, here's the track of an animal in full sprint. It's traveling in that direction, and you've got four paw prints, followed by a long gap, and then four paw prints again. It's counterintuitive to realize when you realize that the two leading paw prints are the front feet and the two trailing paw prints are the rear.
Here it is in slow motion. You should scrub the video back and forth until you convince yourself that the back feet land just in front of the front footprints. Notice how flexible the spine has to be to accomplish this.
I hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching.